Chapter 4. During those first few days in that strange place, I don't think I could have felt worse if I'd lost my arms and legs, rather than my family and my home. I had no doubt my life would never again be the same. All I could think of was my confusion and misery, and I wondered day after day when I might see Satsu again. I was without my father, without my mother, without even the clothing I'd always worn. Yet somehow the thing that startled me most, after a week or two had passed, was that I had, in fact, survived. I remember one moment, drying rice bowls in the kitchen, when all at once I felt so disoriented I had to stop what I was doing, to stare for a long while at my hands, for I could scarcely understand that this person drying the bowls was actually me. Mother had told me I could begin my training within a few months if I worked hard and behaved myself. As I learned from Pumpkin, beginning my training meant going to school in another section of Gion to take lessons in things like music, dance, and tea ceremony. All the girls studying to be geisha took classes at this same school. I felt sure I'd find Satsu there when I was finally permitted to go. So by the end of my first week, I'd made up my mind to be as obedient as a cow following along on a rope, in the hopes that Mother would send me to the school right away. Most of my chores were straightforward. I stowed away the futons in the morning, cleaned the rooms, swept the dirt corridor, and so forth. Sometimes I was sent to the pharmacist to fetch ointment for the cook's scabies, or to a shop on Shijo Avenue to fetch the rice crackers Auntie was so fond of. Happily, the worst jobs, such as cleaning the toilets, were the responsibility of one of the elderly maids, but even though I worked as hard as I knew how, I never seemed to make the good impression I hoped to, because my chores every day were more than I could possibly finish, and the problem was made a good deal worse by Granny. Looking after Granny wasn't really one of my duties, not as Auntie described them to me. But when Granny summoned me, I couldn't very well ignore her, for she had more seniority in the Okia than anyone else. One day, for example, I was about to carry tea upstairs to Mother, when I heard Granny call out, "Where's that girl? Send her in here." I had to put down Mother's tray and hurry into the room where Granny was eating her lunch. "Can't you see this room is too hot?" she said to me, after I'd bowed to her on my knees. "You ought to have come in here and opened the window."
"I'm sorry, Granny, I didn't know you were hot."
"Don't I look hot?"
She was eating some rice, and several grains of it were stuck to her lower lip. I thought she looked more mean than hot, but I went directly to the window and opened it. As soon as I did, a fly came in and began buzzing around Granny's food.
"What's the matter with you?" she said, waving at the fly with her chopsticks. "The other maids don't let in flies when they open the window."
I apologized and told her I would fetch a swatter.
"And knock the fly into my food? Oh, no, you won't. You'll stand right here while I eat and keep it away from me."
So I had to stand there while Granny ate her food and listened to her tell me about the great kabuki actor Ichimura Uzaemon XIV, who had taken her hand during a moon-viewing party when she was only 14. By the time I was finally free to leave, Mother's tea had grown so cold I couldn't even deliver it. Both the cook and Mother were angry with me. The truth was, Granny didn't like to be alone. Even when she needed to use the toilet, she made Auntie stand just outside the door and hold her hands to help her balance in a squatting position. The odor was so overpowering, poor Auntie nearly broke her neck, trying to get her head as far away from it as possible. I didn't have any jobs as bad as this one, but Granny did often call me to massage her while she cleaned her ears with a tiny silver scoop, and the task of massaging her was a good deal worse than you might think. I almost felt sick the first time she unfastened her robe and pulled it down from her shoulders, because the skin there, and on her neck, was bumpy and yellow like an uncooked chicken's. The problem, as I later learned, was that in her geisha days she'd used a kind of white makeup we call china clay, made with a base of lead. China clay turned out to be poisonous to begin with, which probably accounted in part for Granny's foul disposition. But also, as a younger woman, Granny had often gone to the hot springs north of Kyoto. This would have been fine, except that the lead-based makeup was very hard to remove. Traces of it combined with some sort of chemical in the water to make a dye that ruined her skin. Granny wasn't the only one afflicted by this problem. Even during the early years of World War II, you could still see old women on the streets in Gion with sagging yellow necks. One day, after I'd been in the Okia about 3 weeks, I went upstairs much later than usual to straighten Hatsumomo's room. I was terrified of Hatsumomo, even though I hardly saw her because of the busy life she led. I worried about what might happen if she found me alone, so I always tried to clean her room the moment she left the Okia for her dance lessons. Unfortunately, that morning Granny had kept me busy until almost noon. Hatsumomo's room was the largest in the Okiya, larger in floor space than my entire house in Yoroido. I couldn't think why it should be so much bigger than everyone else's, until one of the elderly maids told me that even though Hatsumomo was the only geisha in the Okiya now, in the past there'd been as many as three or four, and they'd all slept together in that one room. Hatsumomo may have lived alone, but she certainly made enough mess for four people. When I went up to her room that day, in addition to the usual magazines strewn about and brushes left on the mats near her tiny makeup stand, I found an apple core and an empty whiskey bottle under the table. The window was open, and the wind must have knocked down the wood frame on which she'd hung her kimono from the night before, or perhaps she'd tipped it over before going to bed drunk and hadn't yet bothered to pick it up. Usually Auntie would have fetched the kimono by now, because it was her responsibility to care for the clothing in the Okiya. But for some reason she hadn't. Just as I was standing the frame erect again, the door slid open all at once, and I turned to see Hatsumomo standing there. "Oh, it's you," she said. "I thought I heard a little mousey or something. I see you've been straightening my room. Are you the one who keeps rearranging all my makeup jars? Why do you insist on doing that?"
"I'm very sorry, ma'am," I said. "I only move them to dust underneath."
"But if you touch them," she said, "they'll start to smell like you. And then the men will say to me, 'Hatsumomo-san, why do you stink like an ignorant girl from a fishing village?' I'm sure you understand that, don't you? But let's have you repeat it back to me, just to be sure. Why don't I want you to touch my makeup?" I could hardly bring myself to say it, but at last I answered her. "Because it will start to smell like me."
"That's very good. And what will the men say?"
"They'll say, 'Oh, Hatsumomo-san, you smell just like a girl from a fishing village.'" "There's something about the way you said it that I don't like. But I suppose it will do. I can't see why you girls from fishing villages smell so bad. That ugly sister of yours was here looking for you the other day, and her stench was nearly as bad as yours." I'd kept my eyes to the floor until then, but when I heard those words, I looked Hatsumomo right in the face to see whether or not she was telling me the truth. "You look so surprised," she said to me. "Didn't I mention that she came here? She wanted me to give you a message about where she's living. Probably she wants you to go find her, so the two of you can run away together."
"Hatsumomo-san,
you want me to tell you where she is? Well, you're going to have to earn the information. When I think how, I'll tell you. Now get out."
I didn't dare disobey her, but just before leaving the room, I stopped, thinking perhaps I could persuade her. "Hatsumomo-san, I know you don't like me," I said. "If you would be kind enough to tell me what I want to know, I'll promise never to bother you again."
Hatsumomo looked very pleased when she heard this, and came walking toward me with a luminous happiness on her face. Honestly, I've never seen a more astonishing-looking woman. Men in the street sometimes stopped and took their cigarettes from their mouths to stare at her. I thought she was going to come whisper in my ear, but after she'd stood over me, smiling for a moment, she drew back her hand and slapped me.
"I told you to get out of my room, didn't I?" she said.
I was too stunned to know how to react, but I must have stumbled out of the room, because the next thing I knew, I was slumped on the wood floor of the hallway, holding my hand to my face. In a moment, Mother's door slid open.
"Hatsumomo," Mother said, and came to help me to my feet. "What have you done to Chiyo?"
"She was talking about running away, Mother. I decided it would be best if I slapped her for you. I thought you were probably too busy to do it yourself." Mother summoned a maid and asked for several slices of fresh ginger, then took me into her room, and seated me at the table while she finished a telephone call. The Okiya's only telephone for calling outside Jion was mounted on the wall of her room, and no one else was permitted to use it. She left the earpiece lying on its side on the shelf, and when she took it up again, she seemed to squeeze it so hard with her stubby fingers that I thought fluid might drip onto the mats.
"Sorry," she said into the mouthpiece in her raspy voice. "Hatsumomo is slapping the maids around again."
During my first weeks in the Okiya, I felt an unreasonable affection for Mother, something like what a fish might feel for the fisherman who pulls the hook from its lip. Probably this was because I saw her no more than a few minutes each day while cleaning her room. She was always to be found there, sitting at the table, usually with an account book from the bookcase open before her, and the fingers of one hand flicking the ivory beads of her abacus. She may have been organized about keeping her account books, but in every other respect she was messier even than Hatsumomo. Whenever she put her pipe down onto the table with a click, flecks of ash and tobacco flew out of it, and she left them wherever they lay. She didn't like anyone to touch her futon, even to change the sheets, so the whole room smelled like dirty linen, and the paper screens over the windows were stained terribly on account of her smoking, which gave the room a gloomy cast.
While Mother went on talking on the telephone, one of the elderly maids came in with several strips of freshly cut ginger for me to hold against my face where Hatsumomo had slapped me. The commotion of the door opening and closing woke Mother's little dog, Taku, who was an ill-tempered creature with a smashed face. He seemed to have only three pastimes in life: to bark, to snore, and to bite people who tried to pet him. After the maid had left again, Taku came and laid himself behind me. This was one of his little tricks. He liked to put himself where I would step on him by accident, and then bite me as soon as I did it. I was beginning to feel like a mouse caught in a sliding door, positioned there between Mother and Taku, when at last Mother hung up the telephone and came to sit at the table. She stared at me with her yellow eyes and finally said,
"Now you listen to me, little girl. Perhaps you've heard Hatsumomo lying. Just because she can get away with it doesn't mean you can. I want to know. Why did she slap you?"
"She wanted me to leave her room, Mother," I said. "I'm terribly sorry." Mother made me say it all again in a proper Kyoto accent, which I found difficult to do. When I'd finally said it well enough to satisfy her, she went on,
"I don't think you understand your job here in the Okia. We all of us think of only one thing, how we can help Hatsumomo to be successful as a geisha. Even Granny. She may seem like a difficult old woman to you, but really she spends her whole day thinking of ways to be helpful to Hatsumomo."
I didn't have the least idea what Mother was talking about. To tell the truth, I don't think she could have fooled a dirty rag into believing Granny was in any way helpful to anyone.
"If someone as senior as Granny works hard all day to make Hatsumomo's job easier, think how much harder you have to work."
"Yes, Mother. I'll continue working very hard."
"I don't want to hear that you've upset Hatsumomo again. The other little girl manages to stay out of her way. You can do it too."
"Yes, Mother. But before I go, may I ask? I've been wondering if anyone might know where my sister is. You see, I'd hoped to send a note to her." Mother had a peculiar mouth, which was much too big for her face, and hung open much of the time. But now she did something with it I'd never seen her do before, which was to pinch her teeth together, as though she wanted me to have a good look at them. This was her way of smiling, though I didn't realize it until she began to make that coughing noise that was her laugh.
"Why on earth should I tell you such a thing?" she said.
After this, she gave her coughing laugh a few more times, before waving her hand at me to say that I should leave the room. When I went out, Auntie was waiting in the upstairs hall with a chore for me. She gave me a bucket and sent me up a ladder through a trap door onto the roof. There, on wooden struts, stood a tank for collecting rainwater. The rainwater ran down by gravity to flush the little second-floor toilet near Mother's room, for we had no plumbing in those days, even in the kitchen. Lately the weather had been dry, and the toilet had begun to stink. My task was to dump water into the tank so that Auntie could flush the toilet a few times to clear it out. Those tiles in the noonday sun felt like hot skillets to me. While I emptied the bucket, I couldn't help but think of the cold water of the pond where we used to swim back in our village on the seashore. I'd been in that pond only a few weeks earlier, but it all seemed so far away from me now, there on the roof of the Okia. Auntie called up to me to pick the weeds from between the tiles before I came back down. I looked out at the hazy heat, lying on the city and the hills surrounding us like prison walls. Somewhere, under one of those rooftops, my sister was probably doing her chores just as I was. I thought of her when I bumped the tank by accident, and water splashed out and flowed toward the street. About a month after I'd arrived in the Okia, Mother told me the time had come to begin my schooling. I was to accompany Pumpkin the following morning to be introduced to the teachers. Afterward, Hatsumomo would take me to some place called the Registry Office, which I'd never heard of, and then late in the afternoon I would observe her putting on her makeup and dressing in kimono. It was a tradition in the Okia for a young girl, on the day she begins her training, to observe the most senior geisha in this way. When Pumpkin heard she would be taking me to school the following morning, she grew very nervous. "You'll have to be ready to leave the moment you wake up," she told me. "If we're late, we may as well drown ourselves in the sewer." I'd seen Pumpkin scramble out of the Okia every morning, so early her eyes were still crusty, and she often seemed on the point of tears when she left. In fact, when she clopped past the kitchen window in her wooden shoes, I sometimes thought I could hear her crying. She hadn't taken to her lessons well, not well at all, as a matter of fact. She'd arrived in the Okia nearly 6 months before me, but she'd only begun attending the school a week or so after my arrival. Most days when she came back around noon, she hid straight away in the maid's quarters so no one could see her upset. The following morning I awoke even earlier than usual, and dressed for the first time in the blue and white robes students wore. It was nothing more than unlined cotton, decorated with a childlike design of squares. I'm sure I looked no more elegant than a guest at an inn looks wearing a robe on the way to the bath. But I'd never before worn anything nearly so glamorous on my body. Pumpkin was waiting for me in the entryway with a worried look. I was just about to slip my feet into my shoes when Granny called me to her room.
"No!"
Pumpkin said under her breath, and really, her face sagged like wax that had melted.
"I'll be late again. Let's just go and pretend we didn't hear her."
I'd like to have done what Pumpkin suggested, but already Granny was in her doorway, glowering at me across the formal entrance hall. As it turned out, she didn't keep me more than 10 or 15 minutes, but by then tears were welling in Pumpkin's eyes. When we finally set out, Pumpkin began at once to walk so fast I could hardly keep up with her.
"That old woman is so cruel," she said. "Make sure you put your hands in a dish of salt after she makes you rub her neck."
"Why should I do that?"
"My mother used to say to me, 'Evil spreads in the world through touch.' And I know it's true, too, because my mother brushed up against a demon that passed her on the road one morning, and that's why she died. If you don't purify your hands, you'll turn into a shriveled up old pickle, just like Granny."
Considering that Pumpkin and I were the same age, and in the same peculiar position in life, I'm sure we would have talked together often, if we could have. But our chores kept us so busy we hardly had time even for meals, which Pumpkin ate before me because she was senior in the Okia. I knew that Pumpkin had come only 6 months before me, as I've mentioned, but I knew very little else about her. So I asked,
"Pumpkin, are you from Kyoto? Your accent sounds like you are." "I was born in Sapporo, but then my mother died when I was 5, and my mother sent me here to live with an uncle. Last year my uncle lost his business, and here I am."
"Why don't you run away to Sapporo again?"
"My father had a curse put on him and died last year. I can't run away. I don't have anywhere to go."
"When I find my sister," I said,
"you can come with us. We'll run away together."
Considering what a difficult time Pumpkin was having with her lessons, I expected she would be happy at my offer. But she didn't say anything at all. We had reached Shijo Avenue by now, and crossed it in silence. This was the same avenue that had been so crowded the day Mr. Beku had brought Satsu and me from the station. Now, so early in the morning, I could see only a single streetcar in the distance, and a few bicyclists here and there. When we reached the other side, we continued up a narrow street, and then Pumpkin stopped for the first time since we'd left the Okia.
"My uncle was a very nice man," she said. "Here's the last thing I heard him say before he sent me away. 'Some girls are smart and some girls are stupid,' he told me. 'You're a nice girl, but you're one of the stupid ones. You won't make it on your own in the world. I'm sending you to a place where people will tell you what to do. Do what they say and you'll always be taken care of. So if you want to go out on your own, Chiyo-chan, you go. But me? I found a place to spend my life. I'll work as hard as I have to so they don't send me away. But I'd sooner throw myself off a cliff than spoil my chances to be a geisha like Atsumomo.'" Here, Pumpkin interrupted herself. She was looking at something behind me, on the ground. "Oh my goodness, Chiyo-chan," she said. "Doesn't it make you hungry?"
I turned to find myself looking into the entryway of another okia. On a shelf inside the door sat a miniature Shinto shrine, with an offering of a sweet rice cake. I wondered if this could be what Pumpkin had seen, but her eyes were pointed toward the ground. A few ferns and some moss lined the stone path leading to the interior door, but I could see nothing else there. And then my eye fell upon it. Outside the entryway, just at the edge of the street, lay a wooden skewer with a single bite of charcoal-roasted squid remaining. The vendors sold them from carts at night. The smell of the sweet basting sauce was a torment to me, for maids like us were fed nothing more than rice and pickles at most meals, with soup once a day, and small portion of dried fish twice a month. Even so, there was nothing about this piece of squid on the ground that I found appetizing. Two flies were walking around in circles on it just as casually as if they'd been out for a stroll in the park. Pumpkin was a girl who looked as if she could grow fat quickly, given the chance. I'd sometimes heard her stomach making noises from hunger that sounded like an enormous door rolling open. Still, I didn't think she was really planning to eat the squid, until I saw her look up and down the street to be sure no one was coming.
"Pumpkin," I said, "if you're hungry, for heaven's sake, take the sweet rice cake from that shelf. The flies have already claimed the squid."
"I'm bigger than they are," she said. "Besides, it would be sacrilege to eat the sweet rice cake. It's an offering." And after she said this, she bent down to pick up the skewer. It's true that I grew up in a place where children experimented with eating anything that moved. And I'll admit I did eat a cricket once when I was 4 or 5, but only because someone tricked me. But to see pumpkins standing there, holding that piece of squid on a stick, with grit from the street stuck to it, and the flies walking around. She blew on it to try to get rid of them, but they just scampered to keep their balance. "Pumpkin, you can't eat that," I said. "You might as well drag your tongue along the paving stones." "What's so bad about the paving stones?" she said, and with this, I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't seen it myself. Pumpkin got down on her knees and stuck out her tongue, and gave it a long, careful scrape along the ground. My mouth fell open from shock. When Pumpkin got to her feet again, she looked as though she herself couldn't quite believe what she'd done. But she wiped her tongue with the palm of her hand, spat a few times, and then put that piece of squid between her teeth and slid it off the skewer. It must have been a tough piece of squid. Pumpkin chewed it the whole way up the gentle hill to the wooden gate of the school complex. I felt a knot in my stomach when I entered, because the garden seemed so grand to me. Evergreen shrubs and twisted pine trees surrounded a decorative pond full of carp. Across the narrowest part of the pond lay a stone slab. Two old women in kimono stood on it, holding lacquered umbrellas to block the early morning sun. As for the buildings, I didn't understand what I was seeing at the moment, but I now know that only a tiny part of the compound was devoted to the school. The massive building in the back was actually the Kaburenjo Theater, where the Geisha of Gion performed dances of the old capital every spring. Pumpkin hurried to the entrance of a long wood building that I thought was the servants' quarters, but which turned out to be the school. The moment I stepped into the entryway, I noticed the distinctive smell of roasted tea leaves, which even now can make my stomach tighten as though I'm on my way to lessons once again. I took off my shoes to put them into the cubby nearest at hand, but Pumpkin stopped me. There was an unspoken rule about which cubby to use. Pumpkin was among the most junior of all the girls, and had to climb the other cubbies like a ladder to put her shoes at the top. Since this was my very first morning, I had even less seniority. I had to use the cubby above hers. "Be very careful not to step on the other shoes when you climb," Pumpkin said to me, even though there were only a few pairs. "If you step on them and one of the girls sees you do it, you'll get a scolding so bad your ears will blister." The interior of the school building seemed to me as old and dusty as an abandoned house. Down at the end of the long hallway stood a group of 6 or 8 girls. I felt a jolt when I set my eyes on them, because I thought one might be Satsu. But when they turned to look at us, I was disappointed. They all wore the same hairstyle, the wera shinobu of a young apprentice geisha, and looked to me as if they knew much more about Jean than either Pumpkin or I would ever know. Halfway down the hall we went into a spacious classroom, in the traditional Japanese style. Along one wall hung a large board with pegs holding many tiny wooden plaques. On each plaque was written a name in fat, black strokes. My reading and writing were still poor. I'd attended school in the mornings in Yoroido, and since coming to Kyoto, had spent an hour every afternoon studying with Auntie. But I could read very few of the names. Pumpkin went to the board and took, from a shallow box on the mats, a plaque bearing her own name, which she hung on the first empty hook. The board on the wall, you see, was like a sign-up sheet. After this, we went to several other classrooms to sign up in, just the same way for Pumpkin's other lessons. She was to have 4 classes that morning: shamisen, dance, tea ceremony, and a form of singing we call nagara. Pumpkin was so troubled about being the last student in all of her classes that she began to wring the sash of her robe as we left the school for breakfast in the okiya. But just as we slipped into her shoes, another young girl our age came running across the garden with her hair in disarray. Pumpkin seemed calmer after seeing her. We ate a bowl of soup and returned to the school as quickly as we could, so that Pumpkin could kneel in the back of the classroom to assemble her shamisen. If you've never seen a shamisen, you might find it a peculiar-looking instrument. Some people call it a Japanese guitar, but actually it's a good deal smaller than a guitar, with a thin wooden neck that has 3 large tuning pegs at the end. The body is just a little wooden box with catskin stretched over the top like a drum. The entire instrument can be taken apart and put into a box or a bag, which is how it is carried about. In any case, Pumpkin assembled her shamisen and began to tune it with her tongue poking out. But I'm sorry to say that her ear was very poor, and the notes went up and down like a boat on the waves, without ever settling down where they were supposed to be. Soon the classroom was full of girls with their shamisens, spaced out as neatly as chocolates in a box. I kept an eye on the door, in the hopes that Satsu would walk through it. But she didn't. A moment later the teacher entered. She was a tiny old woman with a shrill voice. Her name was Teacher Mizumi, and this is what we called her to her face. But her surname of Mizumi sounds very close to Nezumi, Mouse. So behind her back we called her Teacher Nezumi, Teacher Mouse. Teacher Mouse knelt on a cushion facing the class and made no effort at all to look friendly. When the students bowed to her in unison and told her good morning, she just glowered back at them without speaking a word. Finally, she looked at the board on the wall and called out the name of the first student. The first girl seemed to have a very high opinion of herself. After she'd glided to the front of the room, she bowed before the teacher and began to play. In a minute or two, Teacher Mouse told the girl to stop and said all sorts of unpleasant things about her playing. Then she snapped her fan shut and waved it at the girl to dismiss her. The girl thanked her, bowed again, and returned to her place, and Teacher Mouse called the name of the next student. This went on for more than an hour, until at length Pumpkin's name was called. I could see that Pumpkin was nervous, and in fact, the moment she began to play, everything seemed to go wrong. First, Teacher Mouse stopped her and took the shamisen to retune the strings herself. Then Pumpkin tried again, but all the students began to look at one another, for no one could tell what piece she was trying to play. Teacher Mouse slapped the table very loudly and told them all to face straight ahead. Then she used her folding fan to tap out the rhythm for Pumpkin to follow. This didn't help, so finally Teacher Mouse began to work instead on Pumpkin's manner of holding and the plectrum. She nearly sprained every one of Pumpkin's fingers, it seemed to me, trying to make her hold it with a proper grip. At last she gave up even on this, and let the plectrum fall to the mats in disgust. Pumpkin picked it up and came back to her place with tears in her eyes. After this, I learned why Pumpkin had been so worried about being the last student, because now the girl with the disheveled hair, who'd been rushing to school as we left for breakfast, came to the front of the room and bowed.
"Don't waste your time trying to be courteous to me," Teacher Mouse squeaked at her. "If you hadn't slept so late this morning, you might have arrived here in time to learn something."
The girl apologized and soon began to play, but the teacher paid no attention at all. She just said,
"You sleep too late in the mornings. How do you expect me to teach you when you can't take the trouble to come to school like the other girls and sign up properly? Just go back to your place. I don't want to be bothered with you."
The class was dismissed, and Pumpkin led me to the front of the room, where we bowed to Teacher Mouse.
"May I be permitted to introduce Chiyo to you, teacher?" Pumpkin said, "and ask your indulgence in instructing her, because she's a girl of very little talent."
Pumpkin wasn't trying to insult me. This was just the way people spoke back then, when they wanted to be polite. My own mother would have said it the same way. Teacher Mouse didn't speak for a long while, but just looked me over and then said,
"You're a clever girl. I can see it just from looking at you. Perhaps you can help your older sister with her lessons."
Of course, she was talking about Pumpkin.
"Put your name on the board as early every morning as you can," she told me. "Keep quiet in the classroom. I tolerate no talking at all. And your eyes must stay to the front. If you do these things, I'll teach you as best I can."
And with this, she dismissed us. In the hallways between classes, I kept my eyes open for Satsu, but I didn't find her. I began to worry that perhaps I would never see her again, and grew so upset that one of the teachers, just before beginning the class, silenced everyone and said to me,
"You there, what's troubling you?"
"Oh, nothing, ma'am, only I bit my lip by accident," I said.
And to make good on this, for the sake of the girls around me who were staring, I gave a sharp bite on my lip and tasted blood. It was a relief to me that Pumpkin's other classes weren't as painful to watch as the first one had been. In the dance class, for example, the students practiced the moves in unison, with the result that no one stood out. Pumpkin wasn't by any means the worst dancer, and even had a certain awkward grace in the way she moved. The singing class later in the morning was more difficult for her, since she had a poor ear. But there again, the students practiced in unison, so Pumpkin was able to hide her mistakes by moving her mouth a great deal, while singing only softly. At the end of each of her classes, she introduced me to the teacher. One of them said to me,
"You live in the same okiya as Pumpkin, do you?"
"Yes, ma'am," I said, "the Nita okiya."
For Nita was the family name of Granny and Mother, as well as Auntie.
"That means you live with Hatsumomo-san."
"Yes, ma'am. Hatsumomo is the only geisha in our okiya at present."
"I'll do my best to teach you about singing," she said, "so long as you manage to stay alive."
After this, the teacher laughed as though she'd made a great joke, and sent us on our way. Chapter 5. That afternoon, Hatsumomo took me to the Gion Registry office. I was expecting something very grand, but it turned out to be nothing more than several dark tatami rooms on the second floor of the school building, filled with desks and accounting books, and smelling terribly of cigarettes. A clerk looked up at us through the haze of smoke and nodded us into the back room. There, at a table piled with newspapers, sat the biggest man I'd ever seen in my life. I didn't know it at the time, but he'd once been a sumo wrestler, and really, if he'd gone outside and slammed his weight into the building itself, all those desks would probably have fallen off the tatami platform onto the floor. He hadn't been a good enough sumo wrestler to take a retirement name, as some of them do, but he still liked to be called by the name he'd used in his wrestling days, which was Awajiumi. Some of the geisha shortened this playfully to Awaji, as a nickname. As soon as we walked in, Hatsumomo turned on her charm. It was the first time I'd ever seen her do it. She said to him, "Awaji-san!" But the way she spoke, I wouldn't have been surprised if she had run out of breath in the middle, because it sounded like this, "Awaji-san!" It was as if she were scolding him. He put down his pen when he heard her voice, and his two big cheeks shifted up towards his ears, which was his way of smiling.
"Hatsumomo-san," he said, "if you get any prettier, I don't know what I'm going to do."
It sounded like a loud whisper when he spoke, because sumo wrestlers often ruin their voice boxes, smashing into one another's throats the way they do. He might have been the size of a hippopotamus, but Awajiumi was a very elegant dresser. He wore a pinstriped kimono and kimono trousers. His job was to make certain that all the money passing through Gion flowed where it was supposed to, and a trickle from that river of cash flowed directly into his pocket. That isn't to say that he was stealing, it was just the way the system worked. Considering that Awajiumi had such an important job, it was to every geisha's advantage to keep him happy, which was why he had a reputation for spending as much time out of his elegant clothes as in them. She and Awajiumi talked for a long time, and finally Hatsumomo told him she'd come to register me for lessons at the school. Awajiumi hadn't really looked at me yet, but here he turned his giant head. After a moment he got up to slide open one of the paper screens over the window for more light.
"Why, I thought my eyes had fooled me," he said. "You should have told me sooner what a pretty girl you brought with you. Her eyes, the color of a mirror."
"A mirror?" Hatsumomo said. "A mirror has no color, Awaji-san."
"Of course it does. It's a sparkly gray. When you look at a mirror, all you see is yourself. But I know a pretty color when I find it."
"Do you? Well, it isn't so pretty to me. I once saw a dead man fished out of the river, and his tongue was just the same color as her eyes."
"Maybe you're too pretty yourself to be able to see it elsewhere,"
Awajiumi said, opening an account book and picking up his pen.
"Anyway, let's register the girl. Now, Chio, is it? Tell me your full name, Chio, and your place of birth."
The moment I heard these words, I had an image in my mind of Satsu staring up at Awajiumi, full of confusion and fear. She must have been in this same room at some time or another. If I had to register, surely she'd had to register too. "Sakamoto is my last name," I said. "I was born in the town of Yoroido. You may have heard of it, sir, because of my older sister, Satsu." I thought Hatsumomo would be furious with me, but to my surprise, she seemed almost pleased about the question I'd asked.
"If she's older than you, she'd have registered already,"
Awajiumi said.
"But I haven't come across her. I don't think she's in Gion at all."
Now Hatsumomo's smile made sense to me. She'd known in advance what Awajiumi would say. If I'd felt any doubts whether she really had spoken to my sister as she claimed, I felt them no longer. There were other geisha districts in Kyoto, though I didn't know much about them. Satsu was somewhere in one of them, and I was determined to find her. When I returned to the Okiya, Auntie was waiting to take me to the bathhouse down the street. I'd been there before, though only with the elderly maids, who usually handed me a small towel and a scrap of soap, and then squatted on the floor to wash themselves while I did the same. Auntie was much kinder, and knelt over me to scrub my back. I was surprised that she had no modesty whatsoever, and slung her tube-shaped breasts around as if they were nothing more than bottles. She even whacked me on the shoulder with one several times by accident. Afterward, she took me back to the Okiya, and dressed me in the first silk kimono I'd ever worn, a brilliant blue with green grasses all around the hem, and bright yellow flowers across the sleeves and chest. Then she led me up the stairs to Hatsumomo's room. Before going in, she gave me a stern warning not to distract Hatsumomo in any way, or do anything that might make her angry. I didn't understand it at the time, but now I know perfectly well why she was so concerned. Because, you see, When a geisha wakes up in the morning, she is just like any other woman. Her face may be greasy from sleep, and her breath unpleasant. It may be true that she wears a startling hairstyle even as she struggles to open her eyes, but in every other respect, she's a woman like any other, and not a geisha at all. Only when she sits before her mirror to apply her makeup with care does she become a geisha. And I don't mean that this is when she begins to look like one. This is when she begins to think like one, too. In the room, I was instructed to sit about an arm's length to the side of Hatsumomo and just behind her, where I could see her face in the tiny dressing mirror on her makeup stand. She was kneeling on a cushion, wearing a cotton robe that clung to her shoulders, and gathering in her hands a half-dozen makeup brushes in various shapes. Some of them were like broad fans, while others looked like a chopstick with a dot of soft hair at the end. Finally, she turned and showed them to me. "These are my brushes," she said. "And do you remember this?" She took from the drawer of her makeup stand a glass container of stark white makeup and waved it around in the air for me to see. "This is the makeup I told you never to touch." "I haven't touched it," I said. She sniffed the closed jar several times and said, "No, I don't think you have." Then she put the makeup down and took up the pigment sticks, which she held out for me in the palm of her hand. "These are for shading. You may look at them." I took one of the pigment sticks from her. It was about the size of a baby's finger, but hard and smooth as stone, so that it left no trace of color on my skin. One end was wrapped in delicate silver foil that was flecking away from the pressure of use. Hatsumomo took the pigment sticks back and held out what looked to me like a twig of wood burned at one end. "This is a nice dry piece of paulownia wood," she said, "for drawing my eyebrows. And this is wax." She took two half-used bars of wax from their paper wrapping and held them out for me to see. "Now why do you suppose I've shown you these things?" "So I'll understand how you put on your makeup," I said.
"Heavens no.
I've shown them to you so you'll see there isn't magic involved. What a pity for you, because it means that makeup alone won't be enough to change poor Chiyo into something beautiful." Hatsumomo turned back to face the mirror and sang quietly to herself as she opened a jar of pale yellow cream. You may not believe me when I tell you that this cream was made from nightingale droppings, but it's true. Many geisha used it as a face cream in those days, because it was believed to be very good for the skin, but it was so expensive that Hatsumomo put only a few dots around her eyes and mouth. Then she tore a small piece of wax from one of the bars, and, after softening it in her fingertips, rubbed it into the skin of her face, and afterward of her neck and chest. Then she took some time to wipe her hands clean on a rag, and then moistened one of her flat makeup brushes in a dish of water, and rubbed it in the makeup until she had a chalky white paste. She used this to paint her face and neck, but left her eyes bare, as well as the area around her lips and nose. If you've ever seen a child cut holes in paper to make a mask, this was how Hatsumomo looked, until she dampened some smaller brushes, and now used them to fill in the cutouts. After this, she looked as if she'd fallen face first into a bin of rice flour, for her whole face was ghastly white. She looked like the demon she was, but even so I was sick with jealousy and shame, because I knew that, in an hour or so, men would be gazing with astonishment at that face, and I would still be there in the okia, looking sweaty and plain. Now she moistened her pigment sticks and used them to rub a reddish blush onto her cheeks. Already during my first month in the okia, I'd seen Hatsumomo in her finished makeup many times. I stole looks at her whenever I could without seeming rude. I'd noticed she'd used a variety of tints for her cheeks, depending on the colors of her kimono. There was nothing unusual in this. But what I didn't know until years later was that Hatsumomo always chose a shade much redder than others might have used. I can't say why she did it, unless it was to make people think of blood. But Hatsumomo was no fool. She knew how to bring out the beauty in her features. When she'd finished applying the blush, she still had no eyebrows or lips. But for the moment she left her face like a bizarre white mask, and asked Auntie to paint the back of her neck. I must tell you something about necks in Japan, if you don't know it. Namely, that Japanese men, as a rule, feel about a woman's neck and throat the same way that men in the West might feel about a woman's legs. This is why geisha wear the collars of their kimono so low in the back that the first few bumps of the spine are visible. I suppose it's like a woman in Paris wearing a short skirt. Auntie painted onto the back of Hatsumomo's neck a design called Sanbon Ashi, three legs. It makes a very dramatic picture, for you feel as if you're looking at the bare skin of the neck through little tapering points of a white fence. It was years before I understood the erotic effect it has on men, but in a way,
It's like a woman peering out from between her fingers. In fact, a geisha leaves a tiny margin of skin bare all around the hairline, causing her makeup to look even more artificial. Something like a mask worn in no drama. When a man sits beside her and sees her makeup like a mask, he becomes that much more aware of the bare skin beneath. While Hatsumomo was rinsing out her brushes, she glanced several times at my reflection in the mirror. Finally, she said to me, "I know what you're thinking. You're thinking you'll never be so beautiful." "Well, it's perfectly true."
"I'll have you know," said Auntie, "that some people find Chio-chan quite a lovely girl."
"Some people like the smell of rotting fish," said Hatsumomo. And with that, she ordered us to leave the room so she could change into her underrobe. Auntie and I stepped out onto the landing, where Mr. Beku stood waiting near the full-length mirror, looking just as he had on the day he'd taken Satsu and me from our home. As I'd learned during my first week in the Okiya, his real occupation wasn't dragging girls from their homes at all. He was a dresser, which is to say that he came to the Okiya every day to help Hatsumomo put on her elaborate kimono. The robe Hatsumomo would wear that evening was hanging on a stand near the mirror, and he stood smoothing it until Hatsumomo came out, wearing an underrobe in a lovely rust color, with a pattern of deep yellow leaves. What happened next made very little sense to me at the time, because the complicated costume of kimono is confusing to people who aren't accustomed to it. But the way it's worn makes perfect sense if it's explained properly. To begin with, you must understand that a housewife and a geisha wear kimono very differently. When a housewife dresses in kimono, she uses all sorts of padding to keep the robe from bunching unattractively at the waist, with the result that she ends up looking perfectly cylindrical, like a wood column in a temple hall. But a geisha wears kimono so frequently she hardly needs any padding, and bunching never seems to be a problem. Both a housewife and a geisha will begin by taking off their makeup robes and tucking a silk slip around the bare hips. We call this a koshimaki, hip wrap. It's followed by a short-sleeve kimono undershirt tied shut at the waist, and then the pads, which look like small contoured pillows with strings affixed for tying them into place. In Hatsumomo's case, with her traditional small-hipped, willowy figure and her experience of wearing kimono for so many years, she didn't use padding at all. So far, everything the woman has put on will be hidden from the eye when she is fully dressed. But the next item, the underrobe, isn't really an undergarment at all. When a geisha performs a dance, or sometimes even when she walks along the street, she might raise the hem of her kimono in her left hand to keep it out of the way. This has the effect of exposing the underrobe below the knees, so you see, the pattern and fabric of the underrobe must be coordinated with the kimono. And in fact, the underrobe's collar shows as well, just like the collar of a man's shirt when he wears a business suit. Part of Auntie's job in the Okiya was to sew a silk collar each day onto the underrobe Hatsumomo planned to wear, and then remove it the next morning for cleaning. An apprentice geisha wears a red collar, but of course Hatsumomo wasn't an apprentice. Her collar was white. When Hatsumomo came out of her room, she was wearing all the items I've described, though we could see nothing but her underrobe, held shut with a cord around her waist. Also, she wore white socks we called tabi, which button along the side with a snug fit. At this point, she was ready for Mr. Beku to dress her. To see him at work, you'd have understood at once just why his help was necessary. Kimono are the same length no matter who wears them, so except for the very tallest women, the extra fabric must be folded beneath the sash. When Mr. Beku doubled the kimono fabric at the waist and tied a cord to hold it in place, there was never the slightest buckle. Or if one did appear, he gave a tug here or there, and the whole thing straightened out. When he finished his work, the robe always fit the contours of the body beautifully. Mr. Beku's principal job as dresser was to tie the obi, which isn't as simple a job as it might sound. An obi like the one Hatsumomo wore is twice as long as a man is tall, and nearly as wide as a woman's shoulders. Wrapped around the waist, it covers the area from the breastbone all the way to below the navel. Most people who know nothing of kimono seem to think that the obi is simply tied in the back, as if it were a string. But nothing could be further from the truth. A half dozen cords and clasps are needed to keep it in place, and a certain amount of padding must be used as well to shape the knot. Mr. Beku took several minutes to tie Hatsumomo's obi. When he was done, hardly a wrinkle could be seen anywhere in the fabric, thick and heavy as it was. I understood very little of what I saw on the landing that day, but it seemed to me that Mr. Beku tied strings and tucked fabric at a frantic rate, while Hatsumomo did nothing more than hold her arms out and gaze at her image in the mirror. I felt miserable with envy, watching her. Her kimono was a brocade in shades of brown and gold. Below the waist, deer in their rich brown coloring of autumn nuzzled one another, with golds and rusts behind them in a pattern like fallen leaves on a forest floor. Her obi was plum-colored, interwoven with silver threads. I didn't know it at the time, but the outfit she wore probably cost as much as a policeman or a shopkeeper might make in an entire year. And yet to look at Hatsumomo standing there, when she turned around to glance at herself in the free-standing mirror, you would have thought that no amount of money on earth could have made a woman look as glamorous as she did. All that remained were the final touches on her makeup and the ornaments in her hair. Auntie and I followed Hatsumomo back into her room, where she knelt at the dressing table, and took out a tiny lacquer box containing rouge for her lips. She used a small brush to paint it on. The fashion at the time was to leave the upper lip unpainted, which made the lower lip look fuller. White makeup causes all sorts of curious illusions. If a geisha were to paint the entire surface of her lips, her mouth would end up looking like two big slices of tuna. So most geisha prefer a powdier shape, more like the bloom of a violet. Unless a geisha has lips of this shape to begin with, and very few do, she nearly always paints on a more circle-shaped mouth than she actually has. But as I've said, the fashion in those days was to paint only the lower lip, and this is what Hatsumomo did. Now Hatsumomo took the twig of polonia wood she'd shown me earlier and lit it with a match. After it had burned for a few seconds, she blew it out, cooled it with her fingers, and then went back to the mirror to draw in her eyebrows with the charcoal. It made a lovely shade of soft gray. Next she went to a closet and selected a few ornaments for her hair, including one of tortoise shell and an unusual cluster of pearls at the end of a long pin. When she'd slipped them into her hair, she applied a bit of perfume to the flesh at the back of her neck and tucked the flat wooden vial into her obi afterward in case she should need it again. She also put a folding fan into her obi and placed a kerchief in her right sleeve, and with this she turned to look down at me. She wore the same faint smile she had worn earlier, and even Auntie had to sigh from how extraordinary Hatsumomo looked.
Chapter 6. Whatever any of us may have thought about Hatsumomo, she was like an empress in our Okia, since she earned the income by which we all lived. And being an empress, she would have been very displeased, upon returning late at night, to find her palace dark and all the servants asleep. That is to say, when she came home too drunk to unbutton her socks, someone had to unbutton them for her. And if she felt hungry, she certainly wasn't going to stroll into the kitchen to prepare something for herself, such as an umeboshi ojakusi, which was a favorite snack of hers, made with leftover rice and pickled sour plums, soaked in hot tea. Actually, our okia wasn't at all unusual in this respect. The job of waiting up to bow and welcome the geisha home almost always fell to the most junior of the cocoons, as the young geisha in training were often called. And from the moment I began taking lessons at the school, the most junior cocoon in our okia was me. Long before midnight, Pumpkin and two of the elderly maids were sound asleep on their futons, only a meter or so away on the wood floor of the entrance hall. But I had to go on kneeling there, struggling to stay awake until sometimes as late as 2 o'clock in the morning. Granny's room was nearby, and she slept with her light on and her door open a crack. The bar of light that fell across my empty futon made me think of a day, not long before Satsu and I were taken away from our village, when I'd peered into the back room of our house to see my mother asleep there. My father had draped fishing nets across the paper screens to darken the room, but it looked so gloomy I decided to open one of the windows, and when I did, a strip of bright sunlight fell across my mother's futon and showed her hand so pale and bony. To see the yellow light streaming from Granny's room onto my futon, I had to wonder if my mother were still alive. We were so much alike, I felt sure I would have known if she'd died, but of course I'd had no sign one way or the other. One night, as the fall was growing cooler, I had just dozed off, leaning against a post, when I heard the outside door roll open. Hatsumomo would be very angry if she found me sleeping, so I tried my best to look alert. But when the interior door opened, I was surprised to see a man, wearing a traditional loose-fitting workman's jacket, tied shut at the hip, and a pair of peasant trousers, though he didn't look at all like a workman or a peasant. His hair was oiled back in a very modern manner, and he wore a closely trimmed beard that gave him the air of an intellectual.
He leaned down and took my head in his hands to look me square in the face.
"Why, you're a pretty one," he said to me in a low voice. "What's your name?"
I felt certain he must be a workman, though I couldn't think why he'd come so late at night. I was frightened of answering him, but I managed to say my name. And then he moistened a fingertip with his tongue and touched me on the cheek, to take off an eyelash, as it turned out.
"Yoko is still here?"
he asked. Yoko was a young woman who spent every day from mid-afternoon until late evening sitting in our maid's room. Back in those days, the Okean tea houses in Gion were all linked by a private telephone system, and Yoko was kept busier than almost anyone in our Okea, answering that telephone to book Hatsumomo's engagements, sometimes for banquets or parties 6 months to a year in advance. Usually Hatsumomo's schedule didn't fill up completely until the morning before, and calls continued through the evening from tea houses whose customers wanted her to drop in if she had time. But the telephone hadn't been ringing much tonight, and I thought probably Yoko had fallen asleep just as I had. The man didn't wait for me to answer, but gestured for me to keep quiet, and showed himself down the dirt corridor to the maid's room. The next thing I heard was Yoko apologizing, for she had indeed fallen asleep, and then she carried on a long conversation with the switchboard operator. She had to be connected with several tea houses before she at last located Hatsumomo, and left a message that the kabuki actor, Ono Shikan, had come to town. I didn't know it at the time, but there was no Ono Shikan. This was just a code. After this, Yoko left for the night. She didn't seem worried that a man was waiting in the maid's room, so I made up my mind to say nothing to anyone. This turned out to be a good thing, because when Hatsumomo appeared 20 minutes later, she stopped in the entrance hall to say to me, "I haven't tried to make your life really miserable yet, but if you ever mention that a man came here, or even that I stopped in before the end of the evening, that will change." She was standing over me as she said this, and when she reached into her sleeve for something, I could see, even in the dim light, that her forearms were flushed. She went into the maid's room and rolled the door shut behind her. I heard a short, muffled conversation, and then the okya went silent. Occasionally I thought I heard a soft whimper or a groan, but the sounds were so quiet I couldn't be sure. I won't say I knew just what they were doing in there, but I did think of my sister holding up her bathing dress for the sugi boy, and I felt such a combination of disgust and curiosity that even if I'd been free to leave my spot, I don't think I could have. Once a week or so, Hatsumomo and her boyfriend, who turned out to be a chef in a nearby noodle restaurant, came to the okya and shut themselves in the maid's room. They met other times in other places as well. I know because Yoko was often asked to deliver messages, and I sometimes overheard. All the maids knew what Hatsumomo was doing, and it's a measure of how much power she had over us that no one spoke a word to mother or auntie or granny. Hatsumomo would certainly have been in trouble for having a boyfriend, much less for bringing him back to the okya. The time she spent with him earned no revenue, and even took her away from parties at tea houses where she would otherwise have been making money. And besides, any wealthy man who might have been interested in an expensive, long-term relationship would certainly think less of her, and even change his mind if he knew she was carrying on with the chef of a noodle restaurant. One night, just as I was coming back from taking a drink of water at the well in the courtyard, I heard the outside door roll open and slam against the doorframe with a bang.
"Really, Hatsumomo-san," said a deep voice. "You wake everyone."
I'd never really understood why Hatsumomo took the risk of bringing her boyfriend back to the okya, though probably it was the risk itself that excited her. But she'd never been so careless as to make a lot of noise. I hurried into my position on my knees, and in a moment Hatsumomo was in the formal entrance hall, holding two packages wrapped in linen paper. Soon, another geisha stepped in behind her, so tall that she had to stoop to pass through the low doorway. When she stood erect and looked down at me, her lips looked unnaturally big and heavy at the bottom of her long face. No one would have called her pretty.
"This is our foolish lower maid," said Hatsumomo. "She has a name, I think, but why don't you just call her Little Miss Stupid?"
"Well, Little Miss Stupid," said the other geisha, "go and get your big sister and me something to drink, why don't you?"
The deep voice I'd heard was hers, and not the voice of Hatsumomo's boyfriend after all. Usually Hatsumomo liked to drink a special kind of sake called amakuchi, which was very light and sweet. But amakuchi was brewed only in the winter, and we seemed to have run out. I poured two glasses of beer instead and brought them out. Hatsumomo and her friend had already made their way down to the courtyard, and were standing in wooden shoes in the dirt corridor.
I could see they were very drunk, and Hatsumomo's friend had feet much too big for our little wooden shoes, so that she could hardly walk a step without the two of them breaking out in laughter. You may recall that a wooden walkway ran along the outside of the house. Hatsumomo had just set her packages down onto that walkway, and was about to open one of them when I delivered the beer. "I'm not in the mood for beer," she said, and bent down to empty both glasses underneath the foundation of the house. "I'm in the mood for it," said her friend, but it was already too late. "Why did you pour mine out?" "Oh, be quiet, Corinne," Hatsumomo said. "You don't need more to drink, anyway. Just look at this, because you're going to die from happiness when you see it." And here Hatsumomo untied the strings holding shut the linen paper of one package, and spread out upon the walkway an exquisite kimono in different powdery shades of green, with a vine motif bearing red leaves. Really, it was a glorious silk gauze, though of summer weight, and certainly not appropriate for the fall weather. Hatsumomo's friend, Corinne, admired it so much that she drew in a sharp breath and choked on her own saliva, which caused them both to burst out laughing again. I decided the time had come to excuse myself, but Hatsumomo said, "Don't go away, little Miss Stupid." And then she turned on her friend again and told her, "It's time for some fun, Corinne-san. Guess whose kimono this is?" Corinne was still coughing a good deal, but when she was able to speak, she said, "I wish it belonged to me." "Well, it doesn't. It belongs to none other than the geisha we both hate worse than anyone else on earth." "Oh, Hatsumomo, you're a genius. But how did you get Satoka's kimono?" "I'm not talking about Satoka. I'm talking about Miss Perfect."
"Who?"
"Miss I'm so much better than you are, that's who." There was a long pause, and then Corinne said, "Mameha!
Oh my goodness, it is Mameha's kimono. I can't believe I didn't recognize it. How did you manage to get your hands on it?"
"A few days ago I left something at the Kaburenjo Theater during a rehearsal," Hatsumomo said, "and when I went back to look for it, I heard what I thought was moaning coming up from the basement stairs, so I thought, it can't be. This is too much fun. And when I crept down and turned on the light, guess who I found lying there like two pieces of rice stuck together on the floor?" "Don't be a fool. She's much too prissy to do such a thing. It was her maid, with the custodian of the theater. I knew she'd do anything to keep me from telling, so I went to her later and told her I wanted this kimono of Mameha's. She started crying when she figured out which one I was describing."
"And what's this other one?" Corinne asked, pointing to the second package that lay on the walkway, its strings still tied.
"This one I made the girl buy with her own money, and now it belongs to me."
"Her own money?" said Corinne.
"What maid has enough money to buy a kimono?" "Well, if she didn't buy it, as she said, I don't want to know where it came from. Anyway, little Miss Stupid is going to put it away in the storehouse for me."
"Hatsumomo-san, I'm not allowed in the storehouse," I said at once.
"If you want to know where your older sister is, don't make me say anything twice tonight. I have plans for you. Afterward, you may ask me a single question, and I'll answer it."
I won't say that I believed her, but of course Hatsumomo had the power to make my life miserable in any way she wanted. I had no choice but to obey. She put the kimono, wrapped in its linen paper, into my arms, and walked me down to the storehouse in the courtyard. There she opened the door and flipped a light switch with a loud snap. I could see shelves stacked with sheets and pillows, as well as several locked chests and a few folded futons. Hatsumomo grabbed me by the arm and pointed up a ladder along the outside wall.
"The kimono are up there," she said.
I made my way up and opened a sliding wooden door at the top. The storage loft didn't have shelves like the ground floor level. Instead, the walls were lined with red lacquered cases stacked one on top of the next, nearly as high as the ceiling. A narrow corridor passed between these two walls of cases, with slatted windows at the end, covered over with screens for ventilation. The space was lit harshly, just as below, but much more brightly, so that when I had stepped inside, I could read the black characters carved in the front of the cases. They said things like, "Katakamon, ro," stenciled dragons, open weave silk gauze, and "Kuramonsuki, awase," black-crested formal robes with inner lining. To tell the truth, I couldn't understand all the characters at the time, but I did manage to find the case with Hatsumomo's name on it, on a top shelf. I had trouble taking it down, but finally I added the new kimono to the few others, also wrapped in linen paper, and replaced the case where I'd found it. Out of curiosity, I opened another of the cases very quickly, and found it stacked to the top with perhaps 15 kimonos, and the others whose lids I lifted were all the same. To see that storehouse is crowded with cases, I understood at once why Granny was so terrified of fire. The collection of kimono was probably twice as valuable as the entire villages of Yoroido and Senzuru put together. And as I learned much later, the most expensive ones were in storage somewhere else. They were worn only by apprentice geisha, and since Hatsumomo could no longer wear them, they were kept in a rented vault for safekeeping until they were needed again. By the time I returned to the courtyard, Hatsumomo had been up to her room to fetch an inkstone and a stick of ink, as well as a brush for calligraphy. I thought perhaps she wanted to write a note and slip it inside the kimono when she refolded it. She had dribbled some water from the well into her inkstone and was now sitting on the walkway grinding ink. When it was good and black, she dipped a brush in it and smoothed its tip against the stone, so that all the ink was absorbed in the brush, and none of it would drip. Then she put it into my hand, and held my hand over the lovely kimono, and said to me, "Practice your calligraphy, little Chiyo." This kimono, belonging to the geisha named Mamiha, whom I never heard of at the time, was a work of art. Weaving its way from the hem up to the waist was a beautiful vine made of heavily lacquered threads, bunched together like a tiny cable, and sewn into place. It was a part of the fabric, yet it seemed so much like an actual vine growing there, I had the feeling that I could take it in my fingers, if I wished, and tear it away like a weed from the soil. The leaves curling up from it seemed to be fading and drying in the autumn weather, and even taking on tints of yellow. "I can't do it, Hatsumomo-san!" I cried.
"What a shame, little sweetheart," her friend said to me, "because if you make Hatsumomo tell you again, you'll lose the chance to find your sister."
"Oh, shut up, Corinne. Chiyo knows she has to do what I tell her. Write something on the fabric, Miss Stupid. I don't care what it is."
When the brush first touched the kimono, Corinne was so excited she let out a squeal that woke one of the elderly maids, who leaned out into the corridor with a cloth around her head and her sleeping robe sagging all around her. Hatsumomo stamped her foot and made a sort of lunging motion, like a cat, which was enough to make the maid go back to her futon. Corinne wasn't happy with the few uncertain strokes I'd made on the powdery green silk, so Hatsumomo instructed me where to mark the fabric and what sorts of marks to make. There wasn't any meaning to them. Hatsumomo was just trying in her own way to be artistic. Afterward, she refolded the kimono in its wrappings of linen and tied the strings shut again. She and Corinne went back to the front entryway to put their lacquered zori back on their feet. When they rolled open the door to the street, Hatsumomo told me to follow.
"Hatsumomo-san! If I leave the okiya without permission, Mother will be very angry and—"
"I'm giving you permission," Hatsumomo interrupted. "We have to return the kimono, don't we? I hope you're not planning to keep me waiting."
So I could do nothing but step into my shoes and follow her up the alleyway to a street running beside the narrow Shirakawa stream. Back in those days, the streets and alleys in Gion were still paved beautifully with stone. We walked along in the moonlight for a block or so, beside the weeping cherry trees that drooped down over the black water, and finally across a wooden bridge, arching over into a section of Gion I'd never seen before. The embankment of the stream was stone, most of it covered with patches of moss. Along its top, the backs of the tea houses and okiya connected to form a wall. Reed screens over the windows sliced the yellow light into tiny strips that made me think of what the cook had done to our pickled radish earlier that day. I could hear the laughter of a group of men and geisha. Something very funny must have been happening in one of the tea houses, because each wave of laughter was louder than the one before, until they finally died away, and left only the twanging of a shamisen from another party. For the moment, I could imagine that Gion was probably a cheerful place for some people. I couldn't help wondering if Satsu might be at one of those parties, even though Awajiumi, at the Gion Registry office, had told me she wasn't in Gion at all. Shortly, Hatsumomo and Corinne came to a stop before a wooden door. "You're going to take this kimono up the stairs and give it to the maid there," Hatsumomo said to me. "Or if Miss Perfect herself answers the door, you may give it to her. Don't say anything. Just hand it over. We'll be down here watching you." With this, she put the wrapped kimono into my arms, and Corinne rolled open the door. Polished wooden steps led up into the darkness. I was trembling with fear so much I could go no farther than halfway up them before I came to a stop. Then I heard Corinne say into the stairwell in a loud whisper, "Go on, little girl. No one's going to eat you unless you come back down with the kimono still in your hands. And then we just might. Right, Hatsumomo-san?" Hatsumomo let out a sigh at this, but said nothing. Corinne was squinting up into the darkness, trying to see me. But Hatsumomo,
who stood not much higher than Corinne's shoulder, was chewing on one of her fingernails and paying no attention at all. Even then, amid all my fears, I couldn't help noticing how extraordinary Hatsumomo's beauty was. She may have been as cruel as a spider, but she was more lovely chewing on her fingernail than most geisha look posing for a photograph. And the contrast with her friend Corinne was like comparing a rock along the roadside with a jewel. Corinne looked uncomfortable in her formal hairstyle with all its lovely ornaments, and her kimono seemed to be always in her way, whereas Hatsumomo wore her kimono as if it were her skin. On the landing at the top of the stairs, I knelt in the black darkness and called out, "Excuse me, please." I waited, but nothing happened.
"Louder," Corinne said. "They aren't expecting you."
So I called again.
"Excuse me."
"Just a moment," I heard a muffled voice say, and soon the door rolled open. The girl kneeling on the other side was no older than Satsu, but thin and nervous as a bird. I handed her the kimono in its wrapping of linen paper. She was very surprised, and took it from me almost desperately.
"Who's there, Asami-san?"
called a voice from inside the apartment. I could see a single paper lantern on an antique stand, burning beside a freshly made futon. The futon was for the geisha Mameha, I could tell because of the crisp sheets and the elegant silk cover, as well as the takamakura, tall pillow, just like the kind Hatsumomo used. It wasn't really a pillow at all, but a wooden stand with a padded cradle for the neck. This was the only way a geisha could sleep without ruining her elaborate hairstyle. The maid didn't answer, but opened the wrapping around the kimono as quietly as she could, and tipped it this way and that to catch the reflection of the light. When she caught sight of the ink marring it, she gasped and covered her mouth. Tears spilled out almost instantly onto her cheeks, and then a voice called,
"Asami-sa, who's there?"
"Oh, no one, miss," cried the maid.
I felt terribly sorry for her as she dried her eyes quickly against one sleeve. While she was reaching up to slide the door closed, I caught a glimpse of her mistress. I could see at once why Hatsumomo called Mameha Miss Perfect. Her face was a perfect oval, just like a doll's, and as smooth and delicate-looking as a piece of china, even without her makeup. She walked toward the doorway, trying to peer into the stairwell, but I saw no more of her before the maid quickly rolled the door shut. The next morning, after lessons, I came back to the okie to find that Mother, Granny, and Auntie were closed up together in the formal reception room on the first floor. I felt certain they were talking about the kimono. And sure enough, the moment Hatsumomo came in from the street, one of the maids went to tell Mother, who stepped into the entrance hall and stopped Hatsumomo on her way up the stairs.
"We had a little visit from Mameha and her maid this morning," she said.
"Oh, Mother, I know just what you're going to say. I feel terrible about the kimono. I tried to stop Chiyo before she put ink on it, but it was too late. She must have thought it was mine. I don't know why she's hated me so much from the moment she came here. To think she would ruin such a lovely kimono just in the hopes of hurting me."
By now, Auntie had limped out into the hall. She cried,
"Mate mashita."
I understood her words perfectly well. They meant,
"We've waited for you."
But I had no idea what she meant by them. Actually, it was quite a clever thing to say, because this is what the audience sometimes shouts when a great star makes his entrance in a kabuki play.
"Auntie, are you suggesting that I had something to do with ruining that kimono?" Hatsumomo said. "Why would I do such a thing?"
"Everyone knows you hate Mameha," Auntie told her. "You hate anyone more successful than you."
"Does that suggest I ought to be extremely fond of you, Auntie, since you're such a failure?"
"There'll be none of that," said Mother. "Now you listen to me, Hatsumomo. You don't really think anyone is empty-headed enough to believe your little story. I won't have this sort of behavior in the okia, even from you. I have great respect for Mameha. I don't want to hear of anything like this happening again. As for the kimono, someone has to pay for it. I don't know what happened last night, but there's no dispute about who was holding the brush. The maid saw the girl doing it. The girl will pay,"
said Mother, and put her pipe back into her mouth. Now Granny came out from the reception room and called a maid to fetch the bamboo pole.
"Chiyo has enough debts," said Auntie. "I don't see why she should pay Hatsumomo's as well." "We've talked about this enough," said Mother. "The girl should be beaten and made to repay the cost of the kimono, and that's that. Where's the bamboo pole?" "I'll beat her myself," Auntie said. "I won't have your joints flaring up again, Granny. Come along, Chiyo."
Auntie waited until the maid brought the pole, and then led me down to the courtyard. She was so angry her nostrils were bigger than usual, and her eyes were bunched up like fists. I'd been careful since coming to the Okia not to do anything that would lead to a beating. I felt hot suddenly, and the stepping stones at my feet grew blurry. But instead of beating me, Auntie leaned the pole against the storehouse, and then limped over to say quietly to me, "What have you done to Hatsumomo? She's bent on destroying you. There must be a reason, and I want to know what it is." "I promise you, Auntie. She's treated me this way since I arrived. I don't know what I ever did to her."
"Granny may call Hatsumomo a fool, but believe me, Hatsumomo is no fool. If she wants to ruin your career badly enough, she'll do it. Whatever you've done to make her angry, you must stop doing it."
"I haven't done anything, Auntie, I promise you."
"You must never trust her, not even if she tries to help you. Already she's burdened you with so much debt you may never work it off."
"I don't understand," I said, "about debt."
"Hatsumomo's little trick with that kimono is going to cost you more money than you've ever imagined in your life. That's what I mean about debt."
"How will I pay?"
"When you begin working as a geisha, you'll pay the Okia back for it, along with everything else you'll owe. Your meals and lessons, if you get sick, your doctor's fees. You pay all of that yourself. Why do you think Mother spends all her time in her room, writing numbers in those little books? You owe the Okia even for the money it costs to acquire you."
Throughout my months in Gion, I'd certainly imagined that money must have changed hands before Satsu and I were taken from our home. I often thought of the conversation I'd overheard between Mr. Tanaka and my father, and of what Mrs. Fidget had said about Satsu and me being suitable. I'd wondered with horror whether Mr. Tanaka had made money by helping to sell us, and how much we had cost. But I'd never imagined that I myself would have to repay it.
"You won't pay it back until you've been a geisha a good long time," she went on. "And you'll never pay it back if you end up a failed geisha like me. Is that the way you want to spend your future?"
At the moment, I didn't much care how I spent my future.
"If you want to ruin your life in Gion, there are a dozen ways to do it," Auntie said. "You can try to run away. Once you've done that, Mother will see you as a bad investment. She's not going to put more money into someone who might disappear at any time. That would mean the end of your lessons, and you can't be a geisha without training. Or you can make yourself unpopular with your teachers, so they won't give you the help you need. Or you can grow up to be an ugly woman like me. I wasn't such an unattractive girl when Granny brought me from my parents, but I didn't turn out well. Granny's always hated me for it. One time she beat me so badly for something I did that she broke one of my hips, and that's when I stopped being a geisha. And that's the reason I'm going to do the job of beating you myself, rather than letting Granny get her hands on you."
She led me to the walkway and made me lie down on my stomach there. I didn't much care whether she beat me or not. It seemed to me that nothing could make my situation worse. Every time my body jolted under the pole, I wailed as loudly as I dared, and pictured Hatsumomo's lovely face smiling down at me. When the beating was over, Auntie left me crying there. Soon I felt the walkway tremble under someone's footsteps, and sat up to find Hatsumomo standing above me.
"Chiyo, I would be ever so grateful if you'd get out of my way."
"You promised to tell me where I could find my sister, Hatsumomo," I said to her.
"Oh, so I did." She leaned down so that her face was near mine. I thought she was going to tell me I hadn't done enough yet, that when she thought of more for me to do, she would tell me. But this wasn't at all what happened. "Your sister is in a juruya called Tatsuyo," she told me, "in the district of Miyagawa-cho, just south of Gion." When she was done speaking, she gave me a little shove with her foot, and I stepped down out of her way.